KRT K291 Kansas City. Gospel 1590 106.1 FM.
It's 9 o'clock a.m. Welcome to the Morning Glory Show. Turn your volume up and let the word to God pierce your soul. 1590 a.m. on your radio dial and 106.1 on your FM, pal.
Thank you for tuning in to the Morning Glory radio broadcast with Drs. Adam and Adrian Blackstock of Glory Bible Fellowship International Church. Sit back and get ready to receive a word that will transform your life.
Good morning, radio family. This is Prophetess Adrian Blackstock, Executive Pastor with Glory Bible Fellowship International Church. Our senior pastor is Bishop Adam Blackstock. Amen. You're going to want to tune in and text, call some people and get them on the phone. Today, we're going to be dealing with a special topic in behalf of Mental Health Month, which is this month, the month of May. And we're going to be deal with trauma-induced mental illnesses. Okay, trauma-induced mental illnesses. I have a special guest in the studio with me who will be sharing her testimony and will be enlightening you on dealing with mental illnesses. So you can come out and visit us. We have interactive Bible studies on Wednesday. We start at 7 o'clock p.m. We're located at 1126 Northeast Delta School Road in Lee Summit. Our phone number is 816-795-1900. We have coming up this month on the 27th, which is Memorial Day. You can contact the church in reference to being a volunteer or if you want to get your child to be able to participate in Team Believe track and field, which is coming up, but we're having and sponsoring a huge track meet, which is going to take place on Memorial Day. Call the church for more information, 816-795-1900, 816-795-1900, which is on the 27th. And then we have our first Friday's Bring the Heat services, gatherings, whatever you want to call it, but the Holy Ghost is there, which is going to be June the 7th. Amen. At 7 o'clock p.m., all are welcome, and we just see the miracle signs and wonder, and but for what God is going to be doing, which is going to lead us right up into Pentecost Sunday. So we need to you need to know that this is the second feast. For those of you who are partners with us at GBFIC, we are here in this time where we have an open window. We just came out of Passover, which most of you could, you know, correlate that with resurrection. And so when you read Exodus 23, go do your homework. Amen. It says these three times a year you come before me and don't come before me empty handed. We have been hearing of miracle signs and wonders, especially with my guest Becky who's a new believer in Jesus Christ. But because of the power of tithing and understanding of the feast, God has done miraculous work in her life. And we're seeing even at the Believers or GBFIC. And even I got a testimony, daughter, of someone who was visiting with us, and we was doing the teaching on the feast at that time for Mother's Day, and how they really got hit real hard during the tax season last year because of all the change. And this year they got money back, plus they found out that it was getting money back because they overpaid on their house. Oh, and they had been living really strapped to strap, and they happened to be in that service. Amen. And with the anointing is there. GBFIC is fertile ground, so be ready to get your seed in the ground for Pentecost. Amen. And so that God can do those eight blessings, which I list there, as it says in Deuteronomy 16:16, the place that he has chosen. That's the key. The place that he has chosen. And we know for a fact that Glory Bible Fellowship International Church is one of the places that God has chosen, especially for this region. Amen. To get the blessing to the people. You got to understand being connected to the Jewishness of Jesus. Amen. I think that's where, as far as I'm going to go, I'll wait till next week and let Bishop come in. He's better at doing the announcements, but we just wanted to just give those to you so you can come out and come and have fellowship with us and gathering with us. So one of the things I want to look at today, and this is what the Lord had gave me when I shared it with Becky. She was like, that's good. You know, we talk about mental illness. And for those of you who don't know, I have a master's in social work. Graduated from right here from UMKC. Amen. But what God did with me is that when I graduated, he said, give me your degree for the kingdom of God. And I was just obedient enough to do it. Did not know at that time that I was going to be a pastor. It didn't make any sense why I didn't go into the secular world and use that. But I can tell you that being a pastor now, and we're going over 14 years, that it came in handy.
It Amen.
I really don't, and especially I thank God for Bishop. I don't really know how, especially when we're dealing with a lot of mental illnesses, and we talked about that last month, because many people have suffered sexual abuse. Mm-hmm. And we're going to touch, that's going to be touched on, because those, when we talk about trauma, induced mental illnesses. And a lot of those times, those going to show up and manifest in the church.
Amen.
Amen. And so, so when the Father said that I was equipped and it was able to better equip me assisting Bishop and dealing with women and dealing with other individuals that had all these behaviors and knowing how to function and work with them. And although I deal, I'm a prophet and I deal in the area of deliverance, I did not call everything a demon. Okay. So one of the things that we want to deal with, daughter, I want you just to, you know, to be able to share, you know, a little bit about your background, because we're talking about trauma-induced mental illnesses, and just take it, you know, and I'll probably ask you some questions. So please go out and get people to tune into this so that you'll be able to learn and probably perhaps help some people out of your family.
Well, I'm a survivor of satanic ritual abuse, which is known as SRA. And I live with DID, which is dissociative identity disorder. And having been in...
Let me write that. For some of you, they changed the... In the DSM-4, they changed that some years ago. It was multiple personality disorder. And so it got changed to dissociative identity disorder. Okay? So some of you can be able to understand that. Okay? And so... We will talk a little bit about that. And the reason why this is so important for you to understand DID is because many people, and even in the doctors and all of that, label people with schizophrenia, mm-hmm. and they have no idea that it's dissociative identity disorder.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Because we're going to connect with that, because when you're dealing with someone that has dissociative identity disorder, you're not in the church. It may appear to somebody looking like it's a demon, but you don't understand that it's a dissociation and it has its own personality, its own thinking process and all of that. And I'm going to touch on why God allowed that. Notice what I said. God allowed that to happen in individuals so that they can save their lives. But then we're going to touch on when she said satanic ritual abuse, mm-hmm. how Satan and wicked people know that the body can do that and how they use that to be able to, what word I'm looking for, to bring control over,
yeah.
over individuals. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
I just want to say that many churches don't understand how to help a person who's diagnosed with DID. They may sense that a person is different before they have a clear understanding of what DID is about. Many people don't like it because they automatically believe that the person in their church is there to steal their husbands or rob them of the church finances or want to molest their children or some type of murderer. But those remarks may be presented as jokes, but, you know, it really isn't. Many people are diagnosed with DID, are shy, and have trouble speaking to anyone, never mind the men. We may feel like an overwhelming sense of anxiety. I know I did. Like I would replay every message that was spoken in church or individual or group meetings that I've been to, searching for like a wrong move that I have made. But DID doesn't typically present as flirtatious or seductive behavior. I would say that probably 99.9% of people who have DID are terrified of men. And the idea that we go to church or group specifically to try to seduce someone or a married person is normally the furthest things from our mind. It's more likely that we would probably go bungee jumping off of Mount Everest than talk to someone's husband.
And let me ask you, because I see this is your own words.
Yeah.
And it seemed like because there's a stigma, because before you got to us,
mm-hmm.
that this is how other in other church communities that
yeah.
you were portrayed, or that someone, maybe another leader was kept telling that to you.
Yes.
Or
think I was trying to take their husband or something of that nature.
Okay. But, so you can, and we also deal with that because we talk about stigma of mental illness, mm-hmm. you know, or rethink, and just in general, we talk about mental illness. We're talking about post-traumatic stress disorder. We talk about schizophrenia. We're very used to bipolar because sometimes, you know, like I think, what was the earliest diagnosis that they gave you and at what age?
At 6 years old, I was diagnosed with schizophrenia and bipolar disorder.
Okay. That's at 6 years old, people. Could you imagine being diagnosed? And I know we have individuals that work in that setting.
Mm-hmm.
However, the reason why we're talking about, we're speaking about, the title is that the Lord gave me to say today is trauma-induced mental illnesses. Because no one up until your, well, until your 20s,
mm-hmm.
well, let's say it was up until your 20s or 30s, recognized that she had, it was dissociative identity disorder. And then on top of that, mm-hmm. it wasn't until your late 30s,
36
mm-hmm. that when you met me,
when I met you, yeah.
And I was able to recognize that SRA, she mm-hmm. had SRA with the satanic ritual abuse, dissociative identity disorder. That's a difference. Okay. Do I think maybe I need to clear that up?
Yes.
Okay. So we have dissociative identity disorder, which is when a person is under severe trauma, they dissociate. Okay. For instance, even a just basic, I'm just going to use the term basic dissociative identity disorder is that any form of trauma, especially on a young person, God allows the person, you may hear people or see it in movies where they leave out their body, not doing astral projection, because that's something totally different. That's from the satanic kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
But so, and you hear them say, I was looking down. So if I have Thorpers listen to me, you hear them say, I was looking down when I was being molested. I was looking down or what happened. That's because they dissociated. Okay.
Right.
In order, because whatever was going on, it was so painful that the body itself could not take it and the mind could not take it. Jesus allowed that to happen. Mm-hmm. Okay. So when we look at SRA, dissociative identity disorder, it is where individuals deliberately mm-hmm. take small children, because you came out of cult,
yes.
and they force trauma. I want you guys to hear me. This is the reason why I became play in the church. And this, so, and I was thinking about it as the Lord was speaking to me. He says, tell my people, do you think that we should leave individuals who have been under the control of mm-hmm. Satan from the time they was a child, even though they've been taught to do wicked things, because they taught you how to do very wicked things,
yeah.
that do you think that we should be fearful of them and not understand the power that Jesus Christ has to be able to set them free?
That's good.
Okay? And why I'm saying it, because it was not her fault that her parents
mm-hmm.
allowed this and participated for this to happen to her. What I mean, I'm not going to go into graphic details. I mean, if you think about the most wickedest thing that can be done, I'm talking about starting from the age of 3 or 4 years old,
mm-hmm.
just for the sake of this broadcast, so you can understand it, where they deliberately do something wicked to you to make you dissociate mm-hmm. so that then these people were then trained to alter, which because another personality comes forth to be able to do wickedness.
Right.
Now you can add into that.
Well, they would cause so much pain that would cause me to semi-blackout. So I was present, but not present. They wanted to keep me alive, but almost to the point of death so they can create another altar.
And then here's what happens. Now, this is where you have to have the anointing to be able to discern. It's not the core,
mm-hmm.
Becky, who was really dealing with a lot of the demonic spirits.
Yeah.
They would then attach demons to the altars.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, follow me. So then that is where, here it is, she's functioning. She doesn't know, because when a person dissociates, that altar has controlling power over the core.
Mm-hmm.
Cause how many years did you go without even recognizing when you had altars that was living for you?
The longest time, probably 13 years.
Okay.
Cause I didn't remember carrying my two sons.
So could you guys be able to understand? I hope you be able to understand that. So we're talking about those you may be tuning in and say, what are we listening to?
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about a mental illness that is really touched on. The social identity disorder. And I, besides now, Becky is running out rare cases, very high level, but I have somebody else that's a normal person, and she functioned in ministry, and she says that she was diagnosed. They found out that she had the social identity disorder, and that is the reason, because she was severely sexually abused from the time she was a child. And she talked about, and I'll probably get a chance to bring her on the show, how in the church she would have all these manifestations, and the people, you know, how they treated her. No, and they did not understand that it was the altars, because you got to understand these altars, they don't know anything about God or any of that. Right. And over the time period in the 4 years, every altar I deal with, how many altars, you know, functioning altars that we had to send, we had to integrate, that actually they would actually function for years, and they did not know Jesus. And I had that to actually deliver
that
them.
That you actually dealt with probably over 50.
Okay. And they all had names. They all had names, and each one of them, we had to lead them to Jesus Christ. And this is, I only was able to do that because of being in the church setting, and I had intercessors that also supported me as well as Bishop, and in the counseling. There was not always where, you know, we had to deal with a lot of demonic activity.
Oh, yeah.
But thank God we had the power of Jesus Christ. But there were times it was just dealing with a wounded spirit and a wounded soul. Because could you imagine being tormented and abused, and you're a 4-year-old and you were 6 years old and you was 10 years old. And so you're fragmented. That's a good word. Thank you. Holy Spirit told me to say that's fragmented. Think about when the scriptures, you know, talk about fragmentation. Amen. And so if you were to take a vase and drop it, and you see all those pieces, that's what Satan does in the life of a person who has trauma-induced mental illness. She would not have had a mental illness if none of these things happened to her. Some of you who are suffering with mental illness, if you would get to the root and tap into where did that trauma, where did that door open up, you can get set free by the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. Daughter, bring that, read that, read the scripture. I want, and so those you can scripturally read that Luke 8:1-3.
Soon afterward, he went on through cities and villages, preaching and bringing the good news of the kingdom of God. And the 12 were with him. And also some women who had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities. Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had gone out, and Joanna, the wife of Chuza, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others who provided for them out of their means.
So here's where I know you say your testimony came. That you was able to relate to that, to bring you closer to Jesus. Because one of the things is, you know, you felt you wasn't, we did a lot of it where you wasn't worthy or what have you. But when you bring it to the word doesn't lie. So she was able to relate her story. And I was to show her that in scripture. Now, the other one, for sake of time, is, you know, the demoniac. We all hear about that story. We hear that he said he was cutting. We had to deal with, you know, most people don't understand you're dealing with someone that's with cutting. Amen. It's a demonic influence that comes, you know, through that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Because they say a release of the pain. And so we're going to come back. There's a whole lot that go with that. So I want to bring balance to, yes, there is demonic influence, and yes, there is the trauma that, let me say it this way, there is certain trauma that open a person up to demonic influence.
Yeah.
Okay? Unlike in Becky's case, it was really, induced and purposely done by wicked men and women. And then there are cases, because people have suffered traumas, that if they don't get Jesus Christ in their life and the word of God in their life, they become susceptible. Because what? One of the greatest books that has been written that I have given to many of those. So when Amanda came to me, she came to me through Blackstock Hope Ministry, which is a biblical-based counseling, is what I do. Amen. Is the book, The Battlefield is in the Mind, which is written by Joyce Myers. And I have given, used that book as a tool to many individuals, although I have never read the book.
Oh, wow.
And I'm telling you, you know, but I have never read the book, but God, I have given that to individuals because it's in the mind. Yeah. Amen. And one of the greatest scriptures that individuals that suffer with mental illnesses is that you got to put the word of God in. Now, know Amanda, tell, she did not read a Bible till she was what age?
36.
36. Mm-hmm. She did not start. Let me tell you, one of the most powerful tools in her life. You talk about a person that never read the Bible, mm-hmm. that came out a satanic cult. And the most powerful tools is that profound entitling.
Oh, yes.
And here we have Christians
about tithing and how your tithes is a hedge of protection. I can't afford not to.
And we would not have been able to get her to where she is now. I still required of someone that had all these altars mm-hmm. and had all these demonic spirits tithing.
Oh, yeah.
And you don't want to tithe. But she's sitting here who had never been in a church. And only have known Christ for 4 years. Mm-hmm. And how many forms of medication you used to be on?
55.
How many diagnoses that they gave you?
Oh, my gosh. Probably 20-something.
And how many therapists that you had until you got to us at GBFIC?
I probably had six therapists. And then you're the seventh.
Okay.
You're the seventh, but one that is of Christ-based.
Okay, so all that time... no word of God was used. And then some of those therapists
were attached
to the cult.
Yeah.
We were talking about something on the way here about the importance. And I tell individuals about going into the hospitals. I said, how was it that they allowed you? Because I know that was real strange. Mm-hmm. Allowed you to be admitted into mm-hmm. the psychiatric ward. And what did you tell me?
Because there's people from the occult that work there.
So now I'm going to give out a book. And you only need to get this book and read it if you know about deliverance and you are serious about and you believe in demons. Other than that, if you don't get the book and read it. If you want to have an understanding, I got 5 minutes before I wrapped up. He Came to Set the Captives Free by Rebecca Brown. That's the only part, the only book that I'm recommending for the purposes of understanding high level warfare and understanding from another person's point of view, how those demonic spirits infiltrate our lives and how they function around you. I have been to people's jobs out of state because they had a witch working in the next cubicle and they wonder why they're suffering with all forms of infirmities. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you, witchcraft is connected to the spirit of infirmity.
Oh, yeah.
Okay? So you have to understand. You want to touch on that?
It's just as simple as an average Christian. Witches get up to pray. I mean, when I was in the cult and under the coven that my family was, got up to pray to Satan. Christians, they tithe, and Satanists and witches, they have it's not sowing the seeds, it's called planting, where they're giving money. So it's the opposite of what Christians do. It's the same thing.
Because Satan is a counterfeit.
Yeah.
So you got to understand that. So he's still using what God, and that's how I got a lot of the altars integrated mm-hmm. by showing them everything that Satan had them to do mm-hmm. was actually the opposite of what God had in the Bible.
And we're taught.
You hear me, Mr. DJ?
And then when you wake up and you pray, you know, God bless my family, protect me. We were taught to, when we wake up, God cursed them, and we plant curses, because if I can curse as many people, if I can get it rooted into their mind to cause distraction, destruction in their lives, then I would be blessed by Satan.
Okay, see, we got to get you back to come on, because listen, this is why you're supposed to put on the full armor of God, okay? This is, and see, Becky is a blessing to the body of Christ, because if it weren't for us taking her out, see, it was all ordained by God mm-hmm. to connect her with someone out of state that was a part of GBFIC to get her. Listen, yeah. Her faith was, even as damaged as she was, picked up her and her family to get to the house of God by faith, not knowing me or anything, yeah. but because God broke through in a vision and said, this is where you're going to get delivered at, because it's for such a time as this. Mm-hmm. And we don't want to pray. That's the next time. We don't want to pray. We want to do these 15-minute prayers, and you don't understand the reason why Paul is saying, cast down every imagination, mm-hmm. every high thought that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Bring your mind, your will, and your emotions captive to the beams of Jesus Christ. Because if you're not decreeing how your day going to be, mm-hmm. there are like you said, you were trained as children to go out and curse the land. That's the reason why I've been telling leaders how we got to come together, and we've been doing that, that we got to deal with the strong man, because I haven't even touched on territorial spirits that get the foot soldiers.
Oh, yeah.
See, she was considered as a foot soldier that functioned and worked with demons that would go out to curse areas.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we know from Ramirez, who was a warlock that came out, he talked about and told us that he could not go in and curse certain areas where the blood of Jesus was and where people prayed. Wake up, church.
That's true.
Revelation is before. Revelation 12 said we overcome Satan by the power of the blood and the testimony of Jesus Christ, and we love not our lives unto death. We're going to have to take a stand. There's more like Becky that are waiting for righteous leaders. See, that's the thing, the reason why we can't get a lot of y'all set free. Because you can't deal in this realm to bring her somebody out of a satanic cult except you got the power of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You can't have no sin in your life.
Amen.
They will look at you and tell you every wicked thing that you're doing. But I don't have to be concerned about that because I live holy and righteous.
Yes, amen. Yes,
so
did.
They can't call nothing out on me.
Nope.
Amen. Glory amen. Be to God. Becky, anything else you want to say? We got 130 seconds. We got to wrap this up.
I'm just blessed that I'm able to be in the kingdom of God and to continue to work with you and to bring revelation and knowledge to pour out to other people as you and Bishop Blackstock continue to pour into me so I can continue to get delivered and be set free.
Amen. Glory be to God. So once again, this is Prophet Adrian Blackstock. My special guest was dealing with trauma and induced mental illnesses. We're going to get her to come back on. I'm going to do some special trainings at the church in the month of June that deal with the second heaven so you can have an understanding. And as we always say when closing,
Jesus is
Lord.
If this broadcast has been a blessing to you, feel free to partner with us by sowing a seed at gbfic.org or mailing a check to Morning Glory at 1126 Northeast Delta School Road in Lee Summit, Missouri, 64064. If you need special prayer of any kind, please feel free to call us at 816-795-1900.
I'm Debbie D. You've never experienced weight loss like this before. The new Slim Keto Plan is the fastest and easiest weight loss possible. And your weight loss is maximized with Slim for Life's revolutionary patent new product, Keto Booster. The new Keto Booster triggers your body to go into ketosis, increasing the ketones in your body to turn your body into a fat-burning machine, burning stored fat for fuel. I lost 10 pounds the first week, and you can too. Summer is a few weeks away, and it's not too late to lose that unwanted weight for summer and swimsuit season. So call for Slim for Life today and schedule your free consultations and take advantage of Slim for Life 6 weeks for $66, all services included. Exclusive of products and your weight loss is guaranteed. So what are you waiting for? Be several sizes smaller and look your best for this summer. Slim for Life, 10 Kansas cities and St. Joe locations. Check them out at slim4life.com or give them a call at 888-730-9909. That's 888-730-9909. There are hundreds of ways to lose weight, only one to keep it off, and that's Slim for Life. And tell them you heard it from Debbie.
Hi, my name is J.R. Hewley with Premier Auto Plaza. We're located at 1024 East 23rd Street in Independence, Missouri. Here at Premier Auto Plaza, we specialize in credit problems. If you are a first-time buyer or need second-chance financing, we are here to help you. Here at Premier Auto Plaza, we carry all makes and models of cars, SUVs, and trucks and vans from 2008 to 2017, some with remaining factory warranties. It's springtime, which means it's convertible time, and sizzling hot deals for you at Premier Auto Plaza. I will match your down payment up to $500.